Hey, welcome to the Tawa Salvation Army. If you're joining us online, welcome. It's probably warmer in your living room than it is here in Tawa, but glad you can join us. So please bear with us this morning. We have Reese that is riding the sound desk this morning, which is awesome. Okay. Can you stand up? Yeah, too. Yeah. Please stand. Okay. Let me pray, and then we'll get into worship. Father, thank you that your presence is here this morning. God, may we get a tangible sense of what you want to speak to us today. God, may you use us. God, may you move in our presence today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Awesome, and continue to stand as we sing, Mighty to Save.
Save forever, author of salvation.
We thank you that you conquered the grave, that we can call you Savior. Psalm 100 says, I will shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. I will worship the Lord with gladness. I will come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. We enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. And we give thanks to him and praise his name. The Lord is good, and his love endures forever, and his faithfulness continues through all generations. You may take a seat. Your faithfulness continues through all generations. Sue, can I come? Have you come and join us? We've got our first week of Advent this week, which is really awesome. Who's excited for Christmas? Jess is excited for Christmas. And Izzy? Awesome. I'll hand it over to you.
Good morning, family. Today is the first Sunday of Advent, and we have the expectation of hope. The scripture reading is in Jeremiah 33:14-16. The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will fulfill the good promise I made to the people of Israel and Judah. In those days and at the time, I will make a righteous branch sprout from David's line. He will do what is just and right in the land. In those days, Judah will be saved and Jerusalem will live in safety. This is the name by which it will be called, the Lord, our righteous Savior.
One I prepared earlier.
Thanks, Barry. Today we light the candle of expectation and hope. May it remind each and every one of us of God's great promise to us. He is our hope, he is our Redeemer, and he is our Saviour. Amen. Let us pray. Dear Father, during the Advent season, may we be reminded of your promises to us and your fulfillment of them. Help us to prepare our lives for his advent within us. In the precious name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
It's time for soul praise. Thank you. May my simple praise put a smile upon your face. Amen. Elisha?
Now it's time for Island Dash. We sponsor 18 kids in Tonga, one kindergarten and one in Fiji. If you have any spare change, please hold it up in the air and all the kids will come around and collect it. So can all the kids come up the front?
Let us pray. Father, thank you for these offerings. May you take them and may you use them to expand your kingdom over in Fiji and Tonga. God, may you be part of the families and the kids that this money will impact. In Jesus' name, amen. Awesome. Okay, where is my son? He's going to be changed. Okay, he is going to come join me when he comes back. In the meantime, can my panelists, let's call them that, the people who are going to come and hang out with me on stage, can you come and grab a seat? I promised Izzy that if she comes and joins me, that I'll bring Daniel. So Daniel will come join us as soon as, take a seat. Mark and Jolyn. Got to turn this on. Sorry. Okay, welcome. You guys can just figure out the mics between you. We have three. So if you could say your name and either what year in school you're going to be next year or what you're planning, what you're doing, going to spend most of your time doing in the following year. Cool. Do you want to start? Who are you?
I am Isabel.
Yes.
I'm 12 and I go to Tawa Intermediate and I'm a year 7 at the moment, but when I'm older I would like to be a teacher.
That's cool. Okay, who's sitting next to you?
I'm Josh.
Hi Josh.
Hi Josh.
I'm 22 and I'll be doing a youth diploma thingy next year, which should be fun.
In youth work?
Yeah, in youth work.
Just those two forms.
Yeah.
Otherwise he won't be doing it.
Time, Benny. Thanks, Jess.
Cool.
I'm Glenys and I'm older than that. But I will be doing a final paper at university next year for my degree.
Well, that's cool. Awesome. Can someone give Mark a mic? Just one. Just one.
My name is Mark. I'm a year 11 in Tawa College.
Cool. Awesome. Thank you.
My name's Jo Lynn. I'm year 30-something in the year of, in the School of Life.
And what are you doing for work?
Oh, what do I do for work? I am a part-time doctor of a few different jobs. Yeah, it's complicated. But no, I do a little bit of work for New Zealand Immigration, doing immigration medicals. I do a bit of health check. And today I've got a shift at After Hours in Lower Hutt.
There's a range. Awesome. Hey, thank you again for joining me. So this is part one of our sermon. And so today we're going to talk about like hearing from God and how do we hear from the voice of God and how do we get connected in a relational kind of God. And I wanted to have kind of a big range, some adults on the team, youth, children, and young adults. So thank you again for joining us. You can find amongst yourselves who goes first. The first question, which they got beforehand, so they're all prepared, is when you pray, how do you imagine God? Is that like a hard question to just throw you in there?
Prepare,
right? Yeah. Do you want to go first, Izzy?
When I imagine God, I sometimes see him as a person, sometimes not. Either hear him, either here or in heaven.
That's cool. That's awesome.
Okay. I imagine when I pray to God, I get the image of someone smiling at me, and that gives me heaps of peace. And then, yeah, we just go from there, really. And
that's awesome.
Whatever pops in.
Yeah, cool.
The question that Barry texted was about, you know, what when you imagine God, and I kind of thought, well, actually, I'd work on the reality of God. I don't have to imagine him. I just have to accept that he is here because he promised me that he was. Mm. So I just talk as though he's here.
That's cool. That's like that.
Sometimes when I pray, like mainly as a youth, sometimes these pictures in my mind, like for class.
Thanks.
When I pray, I think most of the time I don't have an image of God in my head, but if I did, it would be a portrait, like one of those, you know, school photos portrait. I like that. It's
like
strange.
What?
Like, you know, something like that. Yeah, so it's just, you know, sort of a headshot. But I think most of the time for me, in my mind, it's sort of the space. Yeah, nothing physical.
That's awesome. That's really cool. When I realized, so this was a question that Natalie had in like some of those like date question cards. And we were kind of taken back by it because we never kind of consider the idea of like how do you see God when you pray? And I guess the question for yourself, how do you see God when you pray? And I was talking about how I tend to talk to Father God when it's kind of stuff for me. And I tend to go to the Holy Spirit when I'm praying for others or talking to others. Some of the best times I've had is that I imagine like driving, I do a lot of driving for work and imagine that the Trinity is kind of hanging out with me in the car. So depending on who I want to talk to, they're in the front seat, on my Father God, and then kind of Jesus and Holy Spirit in the back seat. No, like not the back seat of my life, just to clarify, but kind of have really good conversations that way, and that works, you know, really well for me. I like how you shared that you get see God through pictures, and that God talks to us all in kind of different ways. The second question is, how does God kind of speak to you? So do you want to start on this side? Tell them.
I think in a couple of ways, mainly as an impression in my heart, like if I've got decisions to make, I'm quite intuitive, so it's mainly when I sit on the question for a while, then I get a strong sense in my heart, sometimes in visions. And I know that often when I have my own agenda, then it can get a bit difficult. I feel something and also feel something else. I feel what I want to do, and then sometimes I just get really conflicting feelings. And I have to do this very technical thing where I have to sort of, in my head, decide that, you know, to sort of choose not to desire what I want to do. And then I think then I get a sense of what God wants me to do. Often, and often there's peace accompanying it, regardless of what that decision is and how hard it would be. So yeah, that's how I hear from God.
That's cool. Thank you. How do you hear from God, Mark?
I'm not sure, but yesterday when I talked with Joshua about for Christians, I learned that pictures is another way of God trying to speak to you.
Yeah.
Because some people, even the Bible, God talks directly.
Yeah. Cool.
Just learn that God also uses pictures.
Yeah. So you found out yesterday on talking to Josh that God can speak to you through pictures, and God does show you pictures, and that stuff that you've seen. That's awesome. Thank you.
I grew up in a musical family, and Salvation Army hymns and songs, and often it will be a melody or a phrase or something which is a scripture in a that is in music that will just echo and echo and echo and not go away until I sort of say, well, what are you trying to tell me, God? Very, very occasionally I might get a direct scripture verse, an actual reference, but that's only really happened minor times. Other times it might be, yes, a phrase from the Bible, and then I have to, that echoes and just doesn't disappear until I go and search and find where that is in the scripture. And I love to study scripture and read it, and the more I can recognize what God is likely to sound like by thinking, well, this is how he spoke to other people in the past, then the more likely I am to recognize that he's talking to me.
That's awesome. For me it kind of shifts and changes depending on how I want to communicate with him, but the main ones would be music. So it'll be through a song or something we connect. And then the other one is actually films. So films like Lord of the Rings have been a great source of communication with God for me, which is unique but really cool. I enjoy it.
I was praying with Josh the other day, and we were talking, and then he kept getting all these pictures from Lord of the Rings scenes. And he's like, oh, this is the scene, and this is what happened, and this is what God's saying. I'm like, whoa, that's really cool. Lord of the Rings, and there was a couple of other movies. So that was really awesome. Do you mean hold this? You get it? Multitasking, just amazing.
Sometimes I picture him writing on a wall, and sometimes I dream about him.
That's awesome. That's cool. Hey, thank you. So what helps you hear God's voice clearly? Do you want to go first?
Sometimes I get confused, but he says, hello, it is me, your father from heaven. And then he talks.
Okay, that's amazing. Can you repeat that?
So sometimes I get confused, but he says, hello, it is me, your father from heaven. And then he talks.
That's awesome. That's amazing. Hey, thank you for sharing. Cool. Josh?
That's so cool. For me, I say, God, can you speak to me? And then that kind of centers me around to peace. Sometimes I have to be quiet or still to hear clearly. Other times I can just dance around and it's good fun. But in general, if it's clear from God, it's quite loud and it won't really go away. It sticks around.
When you say loud, can you clarify that?
It's distinctive. It drowns out the rest of your thoughts, kind of, and keeps mentally shouting at you. I don't know how
to describe that. Yeah.
I have discussions in my head. I'm not hearing voices, but I'm asking questions and listening to what I'm assuming is God giving me the answer. It's usually in my own voice, but I have to check. I'd rather risk doing that. It might be God telling me to do that. If it is something that sounds like God would be saying, as I said, you know, I study scripture to make sure I'm familiar with the sound of his voice. Mm. And so that if it is something, I'd rather risk doing what I'm prompted to do than miss out and not do what God might be saying to me. And there are other times when it's sure and confident and absolute, and the risk taking is that it doesn't matter what other people react or respond to if I'm prompted to do something. If I'm sure that it is what God has asked me to do, then I'm the one who has to be obedient, not worry about what someone else will think about it.
That's cool. I think, yeah, getting to know the voice of God through scripture. And the other thing I find on top of that is that if it, like, is this good for me? Is this good for those around me? You know, if, I heard God's voice, let's say someone's like, oh, someone hears God say, you know, that you're going to marry that girl, but that girl's married. It's probably not God, you know, so because it's not good. It's bad. You know, is it good for me? Is it good for those around me? Because we serve a good God. Yeah. It's a really good starting point. Mark. What helps you hear God's voice clearly?
Sometimes it's other people who help us hear God's voice clearly.
Mm.
Yes, yeah. Listening to what someone else might say as well and checking it out with someone else.
Well, sometimes when I worship, like for words up and for school, God's pictures in my mind. Yeah. Well, it's an example of like godly positive. Godly positive to me is, even for godly positive is positive to God, like that's normal positive. Like sometimes it's positive to you, but not God.
Yeah.
But godly positive is.
Yeah, those things are possible for God. Yeah.
Positive from God.
Yeah. That's cool. So through worship and those things that are positive from God.
And sometimes. Awesome. For pictures repeat itself.
Yeah.
Like tall mountains.
Yeah.
Like nearly every Sunday, if I keep on repeating.
Yeah. So when we're getting pictures from God, particularly in worship, and they are repeating themselves, or you have phrases that come to your mind, thoughts that keep repeating themselves, they probably paid some attention. And a simple question can be like, Jesus, what does this mean? Father God, what does this mean? Or what are you trying to show me? Cool, thank you. Jolyn?
I think if I'm struggling to know what the right thing is to do or to hear from God, I try and create an atmosphere of calm around myself. And that's through either music or nature.
Jolyn, when you talk about an atmosphere of calm, what do you mean? And what is an atmosphere of non-calm? look like?
So an atmosphere of non-calm would be me in my normal mind, multitasking a lot and just trying to figure out what we're doing and where we're going. And for example, an atmosphere of calm for me is very much more easily achieved in my other job, which is a part-time chauffeur. And so I drive a lot. And so I drive my kids around a lot, just to clarify. And so in the car, when there's music and I really am focused, and I find that for myself that that is quite calming for me. And so I am not so distracted. Mm. Mostly I guess the calm is in my head. If I try and do that, then I find that I can hear God much more clearly. Mm.
Cool. Awesome. Is there anything else anyone wants to add before we close? That's awesome. Hey, I just want to pray for you. Five for being bold enough to step out. Let's pray for them. Father, I thank you for these amazing people, the lives that they live, how they represent you in every day and how you speak to them so clearly. May you continue to show them new ways that they speak to you. Father God, may you bless them. God, may you bless their families. May you go before them and behind them and beside them and all around them. In Jesus' name, amen. Can we give them a round of applause? Awesome. Thank you, guys. Steve.
Where it can be. Right. Okay, bring it up. I wonder what's in there today. Oop, that's all right. Share out the contents and let's have a look. What can we be doing today? Right, let's have a look. What do you have? Popcorn, balloons.
Bread. Popcorn.
More popcorn.
Paper cups.
And what have you got there?
A piece of paper.
What
does
it say on the
bit of paper? Advent, a season of hope and expectation.
Advent, a season of hope and expectation. Well, we're going to be talking about the season of hope and expectation, and it's going to involve, apparently, a great deal of popcorn, some balloons, a loaf of bread, and some cups. I'm curious. Let's go see what this is going to look like. Thank you. Let's go.
Good morning. How are we? Lovely to see you all. We're now going to hear from our TCs, so that's our territorial commanders. For those that are new to the Salvation Army, they're the leaders of New Zealand, Fiji, Tonga and Samoa Territory. Here they are. And they've got something to share with us about next year. So.
Kia ora, bula, malo, talofa. The challenges we faced in 2020 were unforeseen and unpredictable, yet we work together to fulfill our mission, and we're reminded that the only sure foundation is Jesus Christ, the solid rock. We can have assurance as we look forward to 2021 that Christ goes before us. He has a plan and a purpose for our territory. It says in 2 Chronicles 7:14, "If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, and I will forgive their sin and will heal their land." We know that when we are united as an army on our knees, we experience God at work among us, and the Holy Spirit will be present in all we do, in Christ's name.
We believe in the vital ministry of prayer. We believe that when we humble ourselves and seek His face, God hears us and answers our prayers. And as the leaders of New Zealand, Fiji, Tongan and Samoa Territory, we are calling every person, core, centre, mission expressions, divisional and territorial teams to a year of intentional prayer. The theme for 2021 Year of Prayer is Make Room, Come Aside, Come Together. We're asking you to join us in this call to prayer and infuse prayer into all your activities, to make room in your schedules, to come aside personally or corporately, and come together to pray.
We have the message of hope for the hopeless in these demanding and uncertain times, for our territory and for our world. We're an army that goes into battle, not only through compassionate service and provision that we are known for, but also as an army which takes issue with the forces of wrong. Salvationists show a strong commitment to their personal prayer life, but as a body of God's people, we sometimes struggle to experience life-giving corporate prayer. So we want 2021 to be the year when we boldly reclaim vibrant and effective corporate prayer. We want prayer to be a natural part of all we do, not a burden or something extra to fit into our busy programs and lives.
So we invite you all to participate in the Year of Prayer. Bring your creativity and innovation to the place of prayer. Share your unique expressions of prayer and worship. Be intentional about including prayer and praise. The Territorial Secretary for Spiritual Life Development, Colonel Heather Rodwell, is working with all the Divisional Secretaries for Spiritual Life Development and Prayer Coordinators to assist with sustaining the Year of Prayer and resources and ideas. The Year of Prayer commences on Monday, the 1st of February, 2021, and is expected to gather momentum as the Territorial Strategic Plan is released early in the year.
The War Cry and our territorial online platforms will carry information throughout the year as we weave prayer into our daily lives. We look forward to coming together in prayer throughout 2021 for ourselves, our neighbours, our communities, our nations and our army as we seek God's will for the mission of the Salvation Army. God bless you.
We are a movement that goes into battle for others, were the words from our territorial commanders. A year of intentional prayer, to make room, to come aside, and to come together. To make room in our schedules, to come aside individually and corporately, and come together to pray. If you're taking notes, then you could write the sermon title as Connection with the Father. So first of all, I figured we'd start with a little story. Story time with Barry. So sit back, relax. So this story is about a rich man and his son who he really loved. And his son was pretty awesome. So this rich man, he had a wonderful mansion with a massive art gallery. And so the son, he used to go and used to wander the streets of the city. And one day he befriended a beggar. And so he used to visit him every day. And the beggar loved hearing from the young man about the father's house, about the art gallery, and everything about each other's families. And so they became really good friends. And then one day the young man stopped coming. 2, 3, 4 days. And the young man didn't come. And the beggar found out that the young man had suddenly passed away. So this really broke the beggar's heart. So he got some crayons and some paper, and he drew a portrait of the young man. He went to the gate of the mansion and asked the guard if the guard would give this portrait to the rich man. The guard, fairly taken back by the gesture, agreed to. He waited for the right time, and when the rich man drove out in his car one day, he handed this portrait to the rich man and said, "There was a beggar that came and gave this portrait. He's drawn it. Apparently he knew your son very well." And nothing was heard. And a few years later, or some time later, the rich man passed away. And they were going to auction off all the art pieces in the rich man's gallery. So this beggar got some nice clothes to see if he could squeeze in and have a look at some of the art pieces. And he did. And so he wandered down the great halls and admired all the great pieces of art. And there in the middle of the gallery was the portrait of the sun that he drew. And so the auction started, and the auctioneer said, there's one condition, well, the first condition in the will is that the first piece of art to be auctioned off will be this portrait of the young man. And there was grumbles and groans from all the fancy people because they were here for the other artwork. And so the poor man, he reached down in his pocket, pulled out the few silver coins he had, and bidded everything he had. There was no counteroffer. One, two, three, sold, the auctioneer said. As the beggar came up and grabbed the piece of art and started to walk away, the auctioneer said, there's a second condition in the will. And that condition says that whoever bids and buys the portrait of the sun gets the whole art collection. People, when we choose the sun, we get everything that the Father has. When we choose Jesus, we get access to everything that Father God has to offer. I really like that parable. It's pretty awesome. So if you're looking at our first point of today is choosing Jesus. Have we chosen Jesus? Because when we choose Jesus, when we choose the Son, it opens us up to access to everything that Father God has to offer. Point two, loving God passionately. I don't know if does anyone think they can recite our Sarvashanami goals? The Sarvashanami Tawa goals? Or part of them? The values, sorry. The Sarvashanami Tawa exists to pursue God's kingdom and see his realities become ours. So the Sarvashanami Tawa, that's us. We exist to pursue God's kingdom and to see his realities become ours. And we do this by loving God passionately, by loving and serving each other, and by living a culture of honor. And today we're going to continue to talk about loving God passionately. Loving God passionately comes through connection. Can you imagine someone significant in your life? A friend, a husband, a wife, someone that you know really might imagine spending time with them and never talking to them, or not spending any time with them and expecting to have the same, like an awesome relationship. It just doesn't work. We have to communicate with those that we want to have relationship with. And yet, when it comes to our relationship with God, we can tend to be like that. That we'll only talk to him or hang out with him or spend time for him or listen to him maybe once a week. It's like we feed our bodies physical food normally 3 times a day. And that's how we stay healthy. And yet we come to church and we feed our spiritual selves once a week and we expect to be healthy. So a lot of my sermon was preached by the panel, which was really awesome. It's basically my heart today, and we're going to spend some time with, like, just kind of spending some time with God, because I didn't want to speak for long at all. But the idea is that, are we connected with the Godhead? Are we connected with Father God? Are we in relationship with God? Because we can't love others passionately and create a culture of honor if we don't spend time with God. So there were some really cool answers this morning around how do you hear from God? And I hope that you are thinking those kind of questions yourself. How do you hear from God? How does God speak to you? There's a couple of things I want to pray over us, and then a couple of questions that I want to walk us through to see if we can have a conversation with God. Let me pray. If you're joining at home, I want to pray over you as well. In Jesus' name, I break off the idea that hearing from God has to look a certain way. And I release permission over us here and those on the live stream for people to hear God the way that he created them to hear God. Amen. Is Daniel feeding? Okay, that's cool. We're not going to have any keys because my wife's currently occupied. But we're just going to ask God a couple of questions. And we're going to see what he has to say. So for me, I got introduced to kind of this style of prayer a couple of years ago. And it's basically the idea that we're going to ask God a question. We're going to see if he has anything to say to us. As you heard this morning, we can hear God in different ways. Some people see pictures. Some people hear an audible voice. Some people get a thought in their mind. Some people get a feeling. I think there's another one. And there's lots of ways that God speaks to us. And just because you've heard that your brother or your sister or your husband or your wife or a friend hears from God a certain way, it doesn't mean that that's how God wants to speak to you. So, the first question we're going to ask, and so we're going to ask this question out loud, and then we're just going to sit and wait. Silence is scary. Silence is more scary for me, because it seems to like drag out when you're up here. But we're just going to, I want to intentionally kind of create some space to hear from God. So the question is, Father God, show me the ways that I'm already hearing from you. So Father God, show me the ways I'm already hearing from you. So we're going to ask this question out loud, and we're going to do it together so it's less kind of scary. If you're at home, I encourage you, please join along with us and ask these questions. So I'll repeat the question, and then if we repeat it out loud, and then we just listen to see if God has anything to say to us. So Father God, show me the ways that I already hear from you. So Father God, show me the ways that I already hear from you. Kind of looking for the first thing that pops into your mind, even if it doesn't really make a lot of sense. Sometimes God can speak to us and we can overcomplicate it. We can be like, oh, that can't be God, that's my own thoughts. A lot of time God uses our own thoughts. Does anybody, I'm not sure where the white mic is, but does anyone want to share? It's no pressure. But if anyone wanted to share, is something God showed them about how God speaks to you? Reassurance and peace. Oh, that's awesome. I'm gonna, can I give you this mic? Just so that those on the live stream can join in.
Hi, live stream. I tend to have a lot of meetings, but quite often I have a lot of questions. And I find, this most probably sounds really weird, but I find that he turns up at an oblique angle towards the end of a meeting with an answer to a question that I didn't expect from that particular scenario or from that particular meeting. And it could be that the person that I'm meeting with knows somebody who knows somebody who knows somebody. Whenever I get that, I feel a little goosebumpy, and it feels like I feel his presence. And I'm always open to it, especially at the back end of a meeting. Not normally the front end, but generally the back end.
That's awesome.
And just got to be open to it, I think.
Cool. Now, can you go to the mic? That's really cool. So Tony was sharing a couple of things that I picked up that really stood out. So talked about God speaking to you at the back end of the meeting, and so you're kind of getting used to it. And so that's really cool, and it's really important for us to get used to how God speaks to us and be aware. if he's, you know, if he normally talks to you in this space, when you're in those situations, being attentive and being open to what God would say. I need to do the same thing when I'm at the bar. And so I've had some really conversations, cool conversations with people. Like, hey, this is what I think God's saying to you. I was like, hey, does this make sense? And the guy's like, have you been stalking me? I was like, no. And I know him, and that's fine. And so he was like, wow, that's like really amazing and exactly what I needed. And so being attentive, sensitive to what God would want to say to us and to us for others. That's really cool. Is he? Gavin.
Thanks. I find God often points out the parallel with a parable. So from Christ's life and his own teaching, because I think as Christians we often look for some for feelings, for validation of something after all. And often, you know, the feeling is not what God wants to show us. He wants to show us the reality. And I find that that Christ's life on earth, he went through so many different situations that there's always a parable or a story or something that Jesus said. So keeping, I think God keeps me grounded by referring to those things in Scripture, particularly words of Christ, to help me cut through the feeling. We always look for something nice that makes us feel good, don't we? Sometimes God wants us not to do that, go beyond, certainly with me. So,
can I ask, so when you're like unpacking it, God would lead you to a particular voice, a particular piece of Scripture, are there particular ways that you find that God leads you there?
I've studied Scripture a lot in the past, and therefore there's a lot in here. There's a lot of value in it because God can bring things to mind if you've learnt them before, right?
Agreed. Yeah.
And so from having studied and meditated on Scripture before, I can see that, oh, this situation I'm in is like that one.
Yeah.
What was God's teaching? What was Christ's teaching in that one? Ah, right, I should be reflecting in that way. Yeah. That's what he taught us to do.
That's cool. Awesome. Yeah. Thank you. I think that's important that we spend time in Scripture so that God can highlight those, you know, those verses to us. Anyone else? If you're on the live stream and you heard something, feel free to put it in the comments. I'd love to read them later. That would be awesome. Mark. Run, Nat, run.
I just see pictures of candles lit up.
That's cool. That's awesome. So that's a really good point. So Mark got a picture of candles. And so the next kind of question for you, if you got a picture or something that you don't understand, is like, Jesus, can you tell me more about this picture? Or Father God, can you show me more about this picture? Or what does this mean? And just kind of listen for that kind of answer. Dad?
Son. I find that God speaks to me quite regularly through music. Either music that you're listening to or music that you sing. And on a number of occasions when soul praise sings, there's moments in those particular songs that you just think, wow. And you just got to keep singing. But at times I don't want to because the moment's there and he just keeps singing and, yeah, it just speaks to me through music that way. Other times it's those wow moments when you're driving somewhere. And I recall a time when I was driving down Central Otago. And for those of you that know Central Otago, there's nice long roads. And at times you can be the only person on the road and it's middle of the day. This particular day, overcast day, and out of nowhere, the sun just came out and shone straight on the car. And I just had to pull over because it was wow. Music and nature, I think, are the things that God speaks to me quite regularly through.
Yeah, that's cool.
Especially when you're going a bit too fast and you have to slow down. But no, that's not true.
I think I wonder how many times we miss the wow moments because we're busy or we've got things to do, places to be, people to see. And we actually miss those wow moments. Because we're busy. Anyone else? Joy?
Um, life gets pretty frenetic for most of us, and especially at this time of the year. And often I know that I would like quick fixes for things, but God says to us to wait on Him, and just wait in His presence for those answers that we need to come. And He will strengthen our hearts. He will encourage us. And He said, be still and know that I am God. And so when we're getting really frantic, we really just have to still our hearts before Him. And I live in a place where I see beautiful sunsets and hear the birds in the early morning. And those birds somehow remind me of God as they start to sing in the early part of the day. They sing a song. They sing to God somehow. And that should be the way we start our day, singing our praise to God. And yes,
cool. Awesome.
He's there for us if we take the time to look for Him.
Yeah. Cool, thank you. So when I ask God the question, I wasn't going to, wasn't in my notes, but and ask God the question just then, like, how do I hear from you? He reminded me that I hear kind of my own voice, but it's a lot wiser. And it kind of knows the answer that I don't know. And so I do hear like kind of an internal voice. I'm not crazy. It's the Holy Spirit. And so that's how I hear from God, is God's kind of talking to me. And a lot, when I was younger, I was confused because it sounded a lot like me. But we serve a good God, and God produces good things. And so if you're hearing good things, then it's from God. And because God uses, you know, all the good things. We're going to ask another question. And so, give me a second. Let me just have a chat with God. So we're going to ask the question, God, how do I see you? So all do it together. And if you're at home, please join us. So Father God, how do I see you? So Father God, how do I see you? So you're looking for the kind of first thought that pops in your mind. Try not to overcomplicate it or overthink it. If it doesn't make sense initially, that's fine. It's kind of part of the process. So depending on what you see, it's kind of depend on kind of where to next. And so if you saw like a really close, intimate kind of picture with God being close, then that's awesome. That's kind of where we want to be. When I first asked this question, God showed me this picture of Him being in the sky, and He was in heaven, and He was amazing and beautiful. And I was like, oh, that's cool. That makes a lot of sense. And the person leading me through this was like, what? Well, they led me through some stuff which basically showed me that actually I did believe a lie that God was distant, that He was God. He is God in heaven, but He wasn't personal. And so I forgave. We can go through life, and so we have situations through our parents or through others that means that we pick up lies about Father God, about Jesus, and about the Holy Spirit. And so I love my dad, and we have an amazing relationship now. But growing up, I felt like Dad was always kind of, he was definitely provided for us, and it's definitely amazing, and he'll definitely watch this. so it's a bit awkward. And so, but Dad was always there. He provided for us, but I didn't feel like we had, he was close. We didn't have a close relationship growing up. So I believed a lie that Father God was distant because I was distant from my dad growing up. And so I walked through kind of that process of I forgive my earthly father for being distant. And then I choose to separate or I renounce the lie that you, Father God, would want to be distant from me. And then ask Father God, Father God, what is your truth? And I got this amazing picture of Father God standing beside me. And he was like really happy and really close. And so this is quite hard to do on a big scale. And obviously those who are at home that I don't know what's, the Holy Spirit knows what's going on. But Natalie, can you come play some stuff? And so we're just going to see where God wants to continue to do in this space. And so if you got a picture that was, God was kind of distant, walk that through. So, like, Father God, is there someone I need to forgive? Is there someone who taught me or didn't teach me how to hear from you? If someone brings someone to mind, then, you know, I forgive them for intentionally or unintentionally teaching me this lie. So we forgive someone not because they were always wrong or because actually they deserve. Sometimes we feel like it's really hard to forgive someone because we don't think they deserve it. But forgiveness separates us from that pain, separates us from that moment. If you got a picture before and you're not sure about kind of that picture, maybe ask God, God, what does this picture mean? Question you could ask is, so we ask Father God, Father God, how do I see you? You could ask Father God, Father God, how do you see me? Father God, how do you see me? Different ways that God talks to us, through pictures, through words, through feelings, through a sense, sometimes through our thoughts. We have a thought come into our mind. So if you ask Jesus or Father God or Holy Spirit, how do you see me? And you saw something that wasn't good, so you saw yourself as dirty or naughty or sinful or unworthy, or maybe you got a picture of yourself covered in something like mud or like hay or leaves or something like that that wasn't just this amazing picture of you. Then a question that you can ask is Father God, Jesus, Holy Spirit, who taught me the lie? Who taught me that this is how you see me? God brings a picture of a person or thought of a person or group of people to your mind. That's, I forgive this person or I forgive these people for teaching me the lie, for teaching me this lie. Then I disconnect or I break agreement with the lie that this is how you see me. I break agreement with the lie that this is how you see me. what is your truth? If you're asking the questions and you're getting nothing, and you're just getting blank, it doesn't mean you don't hear from God. It means that there's actually just some stuff going on. So you can either ask the question, if you are getting like a blank, you can ask Father God or Jesus, can you write on blank? So can you write on this blank? Or you could ask him, is there someone that I need to forgive who taught me that I can't hear from you? So Nelly's just going to sing. Just ask Nelly can sing and play. She'll just do it. And we'll get spend some more time with God. So ask, there's lots of those kind of questions. You can ask Jesus the same questions. And Holy Spirit the same questions. How do I see you? How do you see me? I want to be really sensitive to the Holy Spirit's here, and the Holy Spirit's, I guess, where you are in your homes or wherever you're watching, and that the dove has come. Nathan shares that the dove has come and rests on our shoulder. The Holy Spirit comes, and we don't want to do something to kind of disrupt the dove or shoo away the Holy Spirit. And so that sense that we feel here, that's God. That's God's presence. Nelly's going to play through a song called Oceans. It's not a new song, but we haven't sung it in a little while. It's one of those songs that came out and everybody loved it and everyone overplayed it. It's just about how you call me out upon the waters, where to the unknown my feet may fail and my faith will stand. If you have pain in your bodies, in this room or on the live stream, as Nelly sings and as we worship, may this song represent God's kingdom coming and falling on you. And Father, may you heal the pain in our bodies.
Oceans arise, my soul will rest in you.
Like for someone here, those are the words that you need to hear. That the ocean is a bit overwhelming. You're struggling to see above the waves. May you focus, may you turn your attention to Jesus, to Father God, to the Holy Spirit, and that He will look upon the waves. May, as these words are being sung and declared over us, the question to ask is, Jesus, what do you want to say to me? What do you want to say to me? What are you trying to say? Do have physical pain in your body, I want to pray for that specifically, or at home, I pray that you'd put a hand on whatever part of the body that hurts, and I want to pray. Holy Spirit, we call upon your name, may you come and may you heal. We exist here in Tawa to see your kingdom become a reality, and in your kingdom there is no pain, there's no suffering, there's no sickness. Someone that's sick, that we know is hurting, that is sick, that needs healing. We know a child that has cancer. We have some other people that we know that are sick and need God's healing. Holy Spirit, may you come. May you rest on that individual and those families, those ones that are in our minds right now. God, we come before you as children, as sons and as daughters, and we stand with the authority that you've given us because of your death and resurrection on the cross, and we declare that sickness has no place, that Jesus, you release your healing by your blood. Thank you, Jesus. Our music team, can you come and join Natalie? If God's saying something to you, just stay in that space. Corporately, if you have something to share, please come share it. There's a space for us to hear from God individually, but to hear from God for others as well. Can you stand? So we're going to sing Mark, Jess, Jolin, thank you for standing. Would the rest of you like to join them? And we're going to sing O Come to the Altar. It's such an amazing song that talks about that we can come into God's presence and that we can join with Him. May we be sensitive to what God's still saying to us and what God wants to continue to do. Thank you. Believe that He is our Savior, that He is wonderful. Because I know sometimes we can sing words, but we don't always recognize or believe it. We're really big as Christians about not lying, but I feel like we sing lies a lot because we sing things that actually we need to ask ourselves, do we believe? So I want to sing that again. And I want us to think about it. Do we believe that he is a savior? That he is wonderful? That Christ is risen? We believe that. But what does that mean for our lives? So we bow down before him. We actually submit our lives to him. Because he is Lord of all. Because Christ is risen. Next verse talks about his Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was already bought with the blood of Jesus. We don't actually have to do anything other than come before him and accept his free gift. That's really hard for us to recognize, I think, because everything costs something. Everybody wants something. Jesus does want something. He just wants relationship with you. Can we sing that again? Our forgiveness, our relationship with you was bought by Jesus. That because of Jesus, because his life, death, and resurrection, we can walk with you like Adam and Eve walked with you in the garden. We can talk with you. I ask that this week you would teach us, your people, how to hear from you more. The ways that we're already hearing from you, that we'd see those wow moments in our lives, that your Holy Spirit would bring those to attention in our lives. And our benediction, it's what I read this morning, Psalm 100, verse 3 says, "Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us. He made you. We are his. We are his people. We belong to him. We are his people, the sheep of his pastures, and because of that, we get to enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise." In Jesus' name, amen. First of all, I want to thank AJ. AJ is amazing. This is a multi-talented man. I wonder who married him. So we basically had one leader that had to do kids' church and the live stream. Which doesn't really work. So AJ gave Risa a crash course on the Sundays today, ran the live stream and played drums. So may God bless you as you serve. I just get a real sense that, you know, that God loves you. God's created amazing talents and gifts in you. We're so blessed to have you here. And that God wants to open up kind of a realm of creative intelligence for you, that God will start to give you kind of heavenly wisdom around creativity, and we're super blessed for that, and I'm super excited to hear about God's doing.
Cool.
Yeah, boss.
Thanks, Barry, for leading us this morning, and Natalie. AJ, we've been here 5 years, didn't even know you played the drums. Now that's out of the bag. Sorry about it, brother. You're on the roster. I just want to say a huge thank you to those that helped with the Stuff the Trailer event yesterday, our Christmas food drive, whether you were at the supermarkets collecting the food, whether you were singing with Soul Praise, or down here at 4 o'clock packing everything and helping us to make the Christmas hampers for this year. We're doing 50 Christmas hampers into our community. And so to get those started was super duper helpful. And we know that you all worked really hard, and there was heaps of people that turned up last night, which meant that we could all go home early. So thank you very much. We're very, very grateful. And Sarah's not here, she's in Kids Church, but she has done a huge work behind the scenes to get all of that happening. So shout out to Sarah, even though she's not there, but that's fine. a couple of items to draw your attention to. Next Saturday, the 5th, at 2:30, is the annual commissioning and ordination of new officers, which is pastors, for those who are new to the army. And that's, of course, our Lizzie and Simi. So they've been commissioned and ordained at 2:30 next Saturday at Wellington City. If you would like to go but would like a ride, just please see me or Nathan, and we can arrange something, whether we take the core van or something like that. Also, Nathan will not be here again next Sunday because his father is getting a long service award, so he's going to support. But I'll be here, yeah, the faithful, and I'm preaching, so hopefully you can support me in that. So that's next week. Is there anything else, section leaders? Oh, here comes Reese. He's all right. He's sore. Yeah, he had 3 wisdom teeth out, and he's just a bit washed out from the anaesthetic.
Yeah, just quickly, so you're preaching next week, and then the week after that is the Christmas pageant.
Woohoo! That's what it was.
There you go. Yes, so there was a little note went up on the Facebook group a couple of weeks ago, just saying reach out if you felt like having a crack at something. We got a few kits, we'll get them to do some stuff, but there's obviously, we're not sort of overwhelmed with them, so there's always a couple of roles for the adults. So those of you that either liked or commented on the post, your names will be noted and we'll be in touch this week with what roles you are going to be assigned. Yeah. Hey, Mary.
What?
Well, it's kind of appropriate. And Daniel didn't quite like the post, but we thought he might like to play baby Jesus this year. But we'll see how we go. there's one usual story with the Gibson creation. There's one rehearsal, and that will be next Sunday in Kids Church. So if you are keen, just hit me up, and we'll do a quick run through next Sunday. It's only next Sunday because I haven't finished writing it yet, and then we'll perform it the following week. So there we go.
And don't have to be afraid, because it's not like you have to have an Oscar or anything like that to be able to perform. And you do have a script, is that right?
Yeah.
And they can use it, so it's not like you have to memorize it in a week. We just really need adults to support our kids, and there's long speaking bits, we would get the adults to do away instead of the kids. Please help. It'll be a lot of fun. Also on that day, Sunday the 13th, we'll have our children's prize giving as well, which we have at the end of each year. So invite your families, friends. It's going to be a good time. Oh, and morning tea. Good morning tea. That's always positive. Your turn? Yes. Is that okay?
That's fine. I just wanted to pass on something that my image of God, and this is something that I've had in my mind since I was really, really, really young. It's a funny story, but I just wanted to pass it on because everyone has their own image of God and Jesus. So when I was in the Littlies primary juniors at Hamilton City Church, where I was at the time, You know, we'd seen these pictures of Jesus, you know, golden hair and all that sort of thing. And I was at home on the Sunday after that, and Mum recalled this story to me, and I've always have this picture in my mind every time we talk about what's your picture of Jesus. And it also fits in very well with what I do currently, ride a motorcycle. Ooh. And of course, God did come down in triumph, but that's okay. My picture of Jesus, of God, is I was sitting at the lounge window watching the road outside, and this guy, I'm assuming it was a guy because not many girls rode bikes then, with long flowing golden hair, rode past on a motorcycle. And apparently I yelled at the top of my voice to my mum, "Mum, I've just seen Jesus go past on a motorcycle." So that's what pops into my head. So if anything pops into your head about your recollection of what Jesus it looks like in your mind, that's what it looks like in my mind most of the time.
So when we say live like Jesus, that's where you get the motorcycle from?
Yeah, it is, but I can't grow my hair long, and if I did, it would be look funny, and I can't grow it on Tawa.
Thanks, Mark. That's funny. Our kids have very specific images of what they think God looks like or how they see God too. And ask your kids, ask your grandkids, your great-grandchildren, because it's really, really helpful to all of us. We, you know, God speaks to us all in different ways. So thank you. Let's time for a cuppa.